Well, Downsview Baptist Church, welcome. Welcome to the opportunity that we still have to honor the Lord, to enjoy the Lord, to worship the Lord, to do so knowing that our brothers and sisters around the GTA, wherever we are gathering this morning, are able to enjoy the Lord together along with us this special day. And so I'm going to begin with a few announcements this morning for our church family. As you know, a couple of things have changed us in these last few days. Our live in-person worship here at the church, well, COVID-19 has intervened, hasn't it? And it just seems that in this short time, the reality is that our in-person worship has been canceled. Now, we're not exactly sure how long. We had said a couple of weeks. Now, even since that video came out, we realize that these restrictions may be in place for some time. So as far as we know, for the foreseeable future, just plan to see us online only. That's the reality of the situation. We do pray that you will worship online. Not just to be a spectator of us online. This is not entertainment. This is the idea and the opportunity and taking the actions to encourage you to worship together the Lord. We will be live on the line, online, every Sunday morning, Lord willing, at 11 a.m. You can go to Downsview Baptist Church. Maybe some of you have gone there already to find your way here today. There is a live stream link there, but there will always be an opportunity through Downsview Baptist Church to get you either to the Facebook page where you'll see the service live, or there'll be a link there where you can see it on a pre-recorded video like you're watching today. We want to encourage you, dear friends, as clearly as we have been told to observe the safety protocols over this past year, getting vaccinated is just that serious. Now, the bad thing is we had a ton of cases in Toronto. The good thing is, because of being a hotspot, vaccines are incredibly readily available. So stick with it. Go online, find your way to an appointment, find your way through a voicemail system or the computer, have someone help you. There's many of us in the church that can help you navigate those systems if you'd like. Dear friends, it is an opportunity and a significant way to love our neighbors better than ourselves. The same as the same priority of wearing masks, it now is a priority of getting vaccinated. It's working. The long-term care homes are not seeing the infections or the deaths like they once did because they were the first ones to get this vaccine. It is a huge area that is used as a sample, and it's good and it works, and under God's providence, He's given us this vaccine, brothers and sisters. So see to it that you do that. Continue. We want to encourage you that we will obey the very simple safety protocols that we're called to, and frankly, the restrictions that the health authorities put in place, they're doing it because we haven't done well at complying with them, and the numbers show it. And so take our time and be diligent and focused that even under this latest stay-at-home order, that we really would seek under God to honor the Lord Jesus Christ and to find ourselves as inconvenient as it is. And some of us is going to be far more than inconvenient. It's going to be downright discouraging. But even in the discouragement and the frustration, we seek to honor the Lord by obeying these kinds of safety protocols. Pray for our Premier, Doug Ford. I just heard him like I felt like I never heard him before last Friday afternoon as he was just begging people, like an emasculated teacher who can't do anything else to the students and just come on, guys. And I think, okay, let's do something. Let's try to be more serious. Let's try to make an example. Let's try to show ourselves to be good citizens. And that's the reason that we shut down at least for a couple of weeks. And so that's where we find ourselves. Now, at the church itself, brothers and sisters, we had our annual meeting last week. And you want to talk about a miracle of technology? You know it was a miracle because I was the one setting it up and running it. And you know how little I know about this. And so the fact that it worked is just a picture of God and a reality that God was caring for each one of us to get that done. We had almost 30 people between in person and online. And praise God. Thank you for coming. Thank you for putting yourself out. Thanks for going out of your comfort zone to stay in this room. Thank you for taking the uncomfortableness to get on Zoom. I don't like being on there. People don't like, I know. Thank you. For those of you who understand a covenant commitment here, sometimes it has a cost. And you paid that. We're thankful for that. Our budget from our financial report from last year and last year's reports were all accepted. Our budget was passed. We're looking forward to moving forward with some steps for an intern, a pastoral intern here at the church in the coming months. Some exciting realities that we pray by God's grace will come to pass in the months. And when we find those wonderful reports, we want you to know that just in the spirit of 2 Corinthians 9:7, each of you should give what you decided in your heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And cheerful giving has led to generous giving here in our church. So praise God for you. Thank you for doing that. We ultimately, the praise goes to God, but the encouragement you should feel. Thank you for understanding the opportunities that we have to, in an ongoing way, give through the e-transfer system, which seems to be real easy. When we get back, we can drop it in the plate. You can certainly drop it in the mail, or one of us would be happy to swing by and pick it up for you as well. Now listen, we were having Zoom calls after church on Sundays, and maybe we're going to do that again, but why don't we do it for the first time this coming Wednesday night at 7 o'clock? Grab your coffee, or maybe because it's the evening, maybe it's an evening tea time. We will send out a link throughout the week for you. And why don't we get together, an opportunity to think through the scriptures a little bit and pray together, and again, just see and hear from each other. Why don't we do that this coming Wednesday night at 7 o'clock? We are now, friends, grateful for the opportunity we have to come together this way. Let's ask God to now focus us on Himself through His Word with our call to worship.
Good morning. Welcome to our service at Downsview Baptist Church, our Sunday morning service. We're so glad to have you with us this morning, and we thank you for tuning in or watching us on YouTube, or wherever you're watching us. We thank Thee that we can come to you this way. We know that we can't meet together personally, but we know that we can meet together around His Word virtually. And we thank you for tuning in today, and we just trust that God's ministry will be an advantage to you, and that you'll be blessed as the pastor shares His Word. We thank Thee that we can gather and read His Word, and we, for our worship, gather to worship. Today we are looking at Psalm 20 in the ESV, the English Standard Version. It's entitled, Trust in the Name of the Lord Our God, written by David. And Psalm 20 reads, May the Lord answer you in the day of trouble. May the name of God, the God of Jacob, protect you. May He send you help from the sanctuary and give you support from Zion. May He remember all your offerings and regard with favor your burnt sacrifices. May He grant you your heart's desire and fulfill all your plans. May we shout for joy over your salvation, and in the name of our God set up our banners. May the Lord fulfill all your petitions. Now I know that the Lord saves His anointed. He will answer him from His holy heaven, and with the saving might of His right hand. Some trust in chariots, and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord God, our God. They collapse and fall, but we rise and stand upright. O Lord, save the King. May He answer us when we call. This is the word of the Lord. Now we're going to have our opening prayer, and you bow your heads with me as we commit our service to the Lord. Our Father, we thank Thee that we can gather in Your name. We thank Thee that because of technology, we can't meet in person, but we can meet virtually. And we thank Thee, our Father, that we can gather around Your Word, Your Word, with our pastor. And we thank Thee for Pastor Peter, and we pray that as he opens the Word today in the book of Philippians, chapter 2, I think it is, we just pray, Lord, that You'll bless him and use him, anoint him as only You can, to reach out with Your Word in a way that would change lives. It's not he that can change lives, Peter himself, but it's You, our Father. Your holy Word can reach into the hearts of people and change them and make them new creatures in Christ. So thank you for today. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for being able to gather in prayer and worship. And we just pray as we meet together virtually that you'll bless our time. Speak to hearts, Lord. Draw people closer to you. May we sense your presence, God. May you speak through your servant, and may Christ be lifted up and draw people closer to him. We pray with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. And all the people said, amen.
Friends, I want to take the opportunity for us to pray together for one of the churches that in our annual meeting and in our new budget, we have increased our support to, meaning we have begun some financial report to the church plant down in Liberty Village, which is Liberty Grace Church. Liberty Grace, of course, is pastored by my good buddy, Daryl Dash and his wife, Char, here. They are seen here outside the church. They planted this church over 8 years ago, and they are persevering in one of the most difficult areas of our city, one of the areas that just has no other church evangelical witness in the area. They continue to press on there, and myself and RJ and Hassan, as we lead there as the de facto, well, the reality is we are the elders of the church, that God has not provided leaders to be raised up there in all those years. And that area has gone from such transition, from a place of incredibly economic poverty, to now an incredibly wealthy place. And because it's so wealthy, it's so difficult for people who were under-resourced and found themselves on the bottom end of the economic spectrum to continue to live there. What must they do? And an opportunity to reach them with the hope and the truth and the joy of the gospel is what Daryl and Char are there doing. I want to encourage you to pray for their new intern. This is Nathan and Elaine Captain. Maybe I've mentioned them to you before. The last Sunday before we shut down last March, not just a month ago, but a year and a bit ago now, Sean Simons was here from the church in Faith Church in New Hamburg, and he had his music team here. Sean Simons' daughter is who Elaine is, and Nathan and Elaine were married this past year, and they were going to do some internship with Liberty Grace Church, and it's already blossomed into a full-time position for him to able to be there. So again, just like we're looking to do, his training is helping with their ministry, and their ministry is contributing to his training. Now, he's got a terrific teacher in Daryl, but they have just moved from St. Catharines into Liberty Village, as you can imagine, one of the most expensive places in our city, but God seems to be providing the resources. And so I want you to hear directly from Daryl at this time. I asked him if he would provide a little video with an update. Daryl is always so quick to give thanks, even for the little bit of support that we're giving, just at $100 a month, but it went from zero to 100, and that's a good thing. And he's just so appreciative. So let's hear from Daryl, and then we will indeed pray together.
Hi, Downsview Baptist Church. Daryl Dash here from Liberty Grace Church, and I wanted to jump on here and thank you so much for agreeing to support us. That means the world to us. We are just so encouraged by your pastor's participation and the way that he's been a blessing to our church, and now for the way that you're partnering with us. So thank you so much. I'm going to be sharing it with our church, and I know that they're going to be thrilled to hear this great news. And if I could, I just wanted to give a couple of praise items and then a couple of prayer requests. I want to praise God. We have an apprentice. His name is Nathan, and he's 22 years old, and he's just moved into the community about a week and a half ago. And we're so excited to have him in the community, another pair of feet on the ground, actually two pairs of feet with his wife, and we're so encouraged that they're here in the community. Second area of prayer, just praise, actually, is our women's Bible study is phenomenal. We're just seeing lives changed as people get in the Word of God. And I want to ask you for prayer for a couple of things. First, would you pray that God would allow us to find a location? Right now, we can't meet in person. At least the numbers don't make sense for us to meet in person. And we're looking for a bit of a larger facility where we can have 15% and capacity, and that would allow enough of us to gather again. So if you would pray for that. And secondly, I'm sitting here in the Liberty Village Park. There's a whole bunch of new condo buildings going up here. It has been super hard to connect with our community over the pandemic. Would you please pray that God would allow us to come up with creative ways to reach out to the community? And then as the pandemic ends, we're just ready to move into the community in a focused season of outreach. So if you would pray for that for us as well. Downsview, thank you so much. I'm so encouraged by your church. You are a blessing to us, and we're praying for you. Thank you so much for partnering with us. We are truly grateful.
Well, it's good to hear from Daryl. I always love his enthusiasm and his humility. Would you join me in a word of prayer for this church, please? Father in heaven, for the ministry of the gospel of grace amongst the disenfranchised and amongst the wealthy, there are needs in both extremes and everywhere in between. And in Liberty Village, this church, Liberty Grace has seen such incredible changes over the years that they've been there. And so I ask, dear God, now for a special outpouring of your kindness upon them. Enable them, equip them with an ongoing desire to sacrificially lay down their ministry lives for the sake of the lives of those who are within the church and those that the church has the opportunity to reach. Dear God, you know full well, if ever there's a church that is an example of one special convert at a time being rejoiced over, it is Liberty Grace Church. They are not a large church. And yet, dear God, you have enlarged people's hearts for that church, the worship that they just love to honor Christ in, the opportunities and the effort again and again and again that Pastor Daryl and now Pastor Nathan make, along with their dear helpmates, Charlene and Elaine. So I ask, dear God, that you would care for them, strengthen their weak hands and feeble knees. Would you, I pray, dear God, give them wisdom. Give them, I pray, a permanent meeting place that they're able to conduct their ministry. Provide from the courts of heaven all the finances that are required. You own the cows on 1,000 hills, dear God. Nothing is too difficult for you. Give them a church home like we so take for granted in this room. Pray, dear God, that you continue to encourage them with the joy of the Lord as their strength. And continue to give them opportunities to disciple and mature the people who have joined together in this church, and that they would have the opportunity to reach out, and that you would be pleased to draw others to yourself through this ministry. Give them the joy of seeing others come to enjoy the Lord as they do. We pray and commit them to your care through Christ. Amen. Friends at Downsview, we come now to the proclamation, the heralding of the word of truth, the word of God. And we do so with the intention, as we began last Sunday in this very same text, to seek the mind of Christ, that our lives would be shaped by gospel thinking. Have this mind in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. That's the overriding central command of where we're going in this particular text. So please take your Bibles and look at the second chapter of the letter to the church at Philippi. And we have been reading from verse 1 right through to verse 18 this week, as we are going to focus in particular on verse 12 to 18. As always, I have my copy of the scriptures here, and I hope that you do as well. But for the sake of our video, I will read what we have off of the screen. And so follow along, see to it that this is indeed the truth that the Lord Jesus has been pleased to encapsulate in his word that is in the very Bibles that we have. Let's read this together. The Apostle Paul has just come through explaining how it is we should seek to live, particularly in light of the prescription he's given us and the description of the Lord Jesus. And now we come to verse 12. Therefore, in light of all of that, in light of who Jesus has been and shown himself to be, who he is, and the ongoing work that he has in our lives, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your salvation. Work out your salvation with fear and with trembling. For, verse 13, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God, without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life. So that in the day of Christ, Paul says, in the day of Christ, I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. Even if I am being poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I'm glad and I rejoice with you all. Likewise, you also should be glad and rejoice with me. You know, we have a lot of reasons in the scriptures whereby we would be encouraged to be certain that what God has started in us, God's going to finish. Sometimes we think of it in a more personal way. Lord, where do I look in the scriptures for assurance that I'm going to stick with you till the end? I know myself, I'm distracted and I'm tempted and I'm easily allured by the things of the world. The Bible in Colossians chapter 3 reminds me to put to death what is earthly to me. I'm still fighting this battle with my old nature. That's a challenge of my Christian life. And I look forward and I think, how do I know I'm going to get to the end with Jesus? Because I look backwards and I think, there's just time and time again, I've failed, I've fallen. Yes, you've picked me up. I wonder, how can I know that you're just not going to eventually just let me go? For some of you, that's an easy answer. I know that. Some of you you're quoting verses now, aren't you? You're quoting theological concepts. Some of you are quoting self-talk. Oh, I just know. That doesn't hold up as much, does it, when the darkness comes? Some of you are quoting what friends tell you. Oh, you'll be fine. Some of you are hoping against hope that the idea that you have, which is a bit doubting and a bit confident, you hope those two things will come together at the end, don't you? Friends, for some people, this is a very real question. How do I know that I'm going to get to the end with Jesus? That if I get hit in a car wreck on the way home tonight and I stand before my Maker, how do I know that I've drifted away in the moment of my sin? How do I know I haven't drifted so far? Again, some of you, you've got a quick and sharp answer and you know chapter and verse, and that's helpful, really good. You've got to know there's some folks who find that a difficult question to answer, partly because what's difficult for the rest of us is to be as honest about our sinfulness before God as other people are. To be honest about our shortcomings and our shortfalls and who I really am in those quiet moments that only you and your wife know. Those private family times that only your husband heard what you said. Then when you put your head on the pillow at night by yourself and you think, God was there through all of it. And I thought I was immune because no one else was watching or only the people who are close to me were watching. Brothers and sisters, how do you know that we're going to get to the end with Jesus? Well, the Apostle Paul is eager to assure this church back in chapter 1 with a very well-known verse, but hear the emphasis of it in chapter 1 and verse 6. And I'm going to back up to verse 3 and come down to verse 6. I thank my God, he says, in all remembrance of you. He's looking back at this church from prison. He's looking back at this church that he had been with when it was planted. And I thank my God in all remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you, making my prayer with joy. Why? Because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And here's verse 6 now. I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Oh, I'm going to make it to the end with Jesus. That's sort of true. Jesus is going to make it to the end, and he will keep you with him. That's what the text says. He who begun the work, he'll bring it to completion. He who started it, he is going to finish it. The one who has saved us is the one who will keep us. That's assurance. That's God confidence, not self-confidence. That's God talk, not personal self-talk. That's not a theological abstraction. That is the word of the ruler of the universe, brothers and sisters. That's what he says. He stakes his reputation on the fact that we will stick with him to the end. God, brothers and sisters, is so certain, and we can be so certain, that he will finish what he started, because he even speaks of such incredible intimacy with us that it says in the book of Isaiah, I have inscribed you on the very palm of my hands. Isaiah 49:16 says that he has inscribed or engraved us on his hands. Think about that. I have a little scar on my knuckle here that I drew a saw along in about grade 7. And whenever I look at my hands, I can remember that event because I've got something that points to it. I broke my finger a few years ago and I've got a little bump here. Every time I look at it, it represents something, reminds me of something. The Lord Jesus holds up his hands and he has Ruth LeBlanc written right there. He holds up his hands and it says, Ismay Murray, on his hand. He holds up his hands and it says, Raphael, it says, Ranillo, it says, Grant and Errol and Ivan. It says the names of their family. It says the names of others in the church. It says your friends and your family that you know the Lord. The Lord Jesus is so committed to finishing what he starts that he is not only staking his reputation, it's on his hands. He is known in intimate connection with every one of his people. He has inscribed my name on his hands. Brothers and sisters, let that hit you. As we're thinking about the mind of Christ, it's that the Lord Jesus is willing to identify, be identified in that kind of intimate connection with each of his children. You know, most of you know Pam Charlebois as the pastor's wife. And you know, the honoring thing to me and the thrilling thing to me is she doesn't mind being known by that. She doesn't mind being known as my wife. When I am known in some circles as the manager of the Dorothy Lay Hospice's husband, oh, that's Pete, that's Pam's husband. Wow, boy, how did he land her? Boy, he sure married above himself, didn't he? Boy, got himself one there, didn't he? Not the kind of... I did marry above myself. But my wife is not ashamed to be identified as the pastor's wife. There are people in the church, and you think about that. Oh, Matthew, that's Vlad and Diana's son. That's who he is. As opposed to, we are Matthew's parents. See how the connection goes? Sometimes we're known by the person we're associated with. Oh, that person is the pastor of Downsview Baptist Church versus that's Downsview Baptist Church's pastor. There's a connection. There's an intimate connection. There's an identification with. Oh, that's Carolyn. That's the gal who sits in the front row with her hands up and that effervescent smile, right? That's Chandra, who's in the back row with that great big a smile that just attracts people to her. There, we are known and connected to and identified with that kind of connection. The Lord Jesus Christ, brothers and sisters, is willing to be so identified with us that, oh, that's my child. Think about the book of Job. Have you considered my servant Job? God is speaking like that, that he's connected. There's an intimacy. God is not ashamed of you being a part of him. Just that connected. God is willing to be identified. His identity, he's identified with you. Just so like those other relationships humanly that we have. Friends, as we are in Christ, we are intimately connected to him. That's the truth of it. Since, listen now, think of the inscription again. Since our lives are inscribed upon his hand, what? His character is inscribed upon our hearts. He is so connected to us that he is identified with us. And since he is identified with us, he will finish what he has started in us. We're just that connected. His very mission is connected to the redemption of those that he has engraved on his hands. And since we are that connected, that's where the change comes. That's where the perseverance comes from. That's why you and I know we will not get to the end without Jesus, because he will not let us go, because he has again identified us with himself, so engraved, almost tattooed, if you will, on his hands. And therefore, he is inscribing his character on our hearts. Brothers and sisters, we've been in this text for a few weeks and we've seen the prescription in the first couple of verses. What are we called to do? To think about others as better than ourselves. How are we to do that? Well, it's with the description of the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ. To think about others as Jesus did. Better than ourselves? Here's what better than ourselves mean. Like this, the way Jesus has thought about us and the way Jesus has treated us. And the prescription leads to the description, which now he comes to the character change, which is the inscription from verses 12 to 18. Have this mind in yourselves, engraved in yourselves, imprinted upon yourselves. The way we are called to live in these very practical coming verses is the inscription of Christ upon our hearts. Now there's a place for confidence. There's a place for worship. There's a place to find joy in the midst of the discouragement and the disappointments and even the disagreements that we have with so much of going on, of what's going on in our lives even now, right? This picture of Christ, the description of Christ, ought to be what we are known for. We should not be known apart from that kind of connection with Christ, and it will be shown by that character that flows from that connection that gives us confidence, but also gives us character alteration and change. And that's how we should be known. This way of thinking should be seen in your living. Have this mind in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Have this mind among yourselves, it says, which was yours or is yours in Christ Jesus. A slightly different translation there, but it is what is in Christ is in you. As we have the mind of Christ, it should be inscribed, his character, upon our very lives. Brothers and sisters, when people see us, this kind of thinking, this mind of Christ, this kind of thinking should be what they see in our living. That's just the reality of what God is calling us to do as his people. And so you remember here, it begins in verse 12, work out your salvation as it was intended to be used. Remember we said last week, work out your salvation isn't work for or towards your salvation. These are Christian people. He has affirmed that in a number of different ways. It's work it out. Take it for a workout. Work it, exercise it, use it as your salvation is intended to be used. Take it, again, work it out, exercise it, use it, put your salvation to work. That's the goal. And working it out is working it into our hearts and lives. Work out your salvation means working out the character of Christ that he's imprinting upon our hearts. Not so that we'd be saved, but this is what happens to people who are made right, who have their right standing with God. Working out your salvation is working it into the character of our hearts and lives. And it's the character of Christ. And it's these seven aspects of this workout. What aspects of this workout? Is it going to be cardio? Is it going to be weights? Right? Or are we going to run long distances? Are we going to do sprints and shortly? Are we going to do exercise on the treadmill? Are we going to, again, use strength training? Or what's this workout going to look like? There's all kinds of ways we can do that. And it's all different individually. And yet, here's what he calls us to, doesn't he? This was the first one. Do you remember last week in verse 14? You got your Bibles? Are you still there? Move down to verse 14. Do all things without grumbling or disputing. Grumbling, complaining, whining, and disputing, fighting, disputes, not getting along with each other. We are called, just as Jesus did not grumble or dispute with his heavenly Father as he was on the way to purchase our salvation, we now have that salvation, and the part of the workout of that salvation is to work it out like this and imprint this character of Christ, inscribe it upon our hearts, that we are not people who crumble and complain and dispute with one another. Reality is, because I desire or demand others to think of me as better than themselves, think of that for a second. This is the cause of so much of my disputing, so much of my complaining. Not to think of others better than myself, but I desire or I demand others would think of me as better than themselves. This is like twisting the text around to the wrong audience. You're supposed to treat me as better than yourself. Of course, that's a true statement, but who's Jesus saying it to? Hey, Pete, tell this to your wife. You know, you're supposed to submit to me as unto the Lord. That's not written to me to tell my wife. That's written from Jesus to tell her. He tells me, you love your wife as I've loved the church and gave myself up for her. Do you understand how that's done? We don't flip it around and have the different audience and say, you're supposed to do this. There's an aspect of teaching and understanding and mutual building up, of course. But brothers and sisters, the complaining and disputing, so much of it is because I demand that other people do what God tells them. And I'm happy to tell them what God has told them to do, when it's also precisely what God has called me to do. I really don't want to live for Jesus. I only want Jesus to live for me. Think about that as a diagnostic of our lives, brothers and sisters. Oh, I believe. Oh, I have faith. Oh, I believe in God. Okay. What does that mean? Does it translate into how we live different? Right thinking, the mind of Christ, will lead to right living. That's the connection throughout this text. And so when we say, do you want to live for Jesus? I want to live for Jesus. I want to believe as much as I have to that I don't go to hell. That's not living for Jesus. It's a beautiful benefit of what God has purchased for us in Christ. And there's much to be made of that, to be sure. But this text is calling us to imprint and engrave the character of Christ upon our hearts. And the way we do that is by living for Jesus. That's what it means to be a saved person. That's what it means to have this salvation. I will live for Christ. And too many times, when we're honest with ourselves in those quiet moments before the Lord, I don't want to live for you. I just want you to live for me. And you hear Jesus in the gospel saying, I have lived for you. And I've died for you. That's what he's just said in all of these previous verses, right? from verse 5 and following, have this mind in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant. And being born in the likeness of men, Christmas time, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross, Easter time. Therefore, God has highly exalted him. This is who Jesus is. He has lived for you. He has died for you. But you see, the people who've committed themselves to me or engraved on my heart show that I have lived for them by them now living for the honor of me. That's what Jesus says. That's how it's done. That's the connection. Work it out. Take your salvation for a workout. Put it to work the way I've designed it to be. And ask God, brothers and sisters, when we find ourselves falling victim to just this temptation, that he would grant us repentance, that we would change, that we would, number one, do all things without complaining or disputing, and that we would be free of unresolved sins. In verse 15, you come back to that saying, do all things without grumbling or disputing, so that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation. Blameless, innocent, doesn't mean perfect. It doesn't mean holiness. It means you've got nothing to account for, that you're holding back, that God can say, what about that? You ever dealt with that? You ever come before me and ask for forgiveness? Repent of that, turn from that, show that you've really been forgiven by changing your life? Not to earn salvation. Again, this is what children of God do to honor their Father. They do it for the express purpose of honoring him. There's no unresolved things with us, Lord. There's nothing outstanding here. Again, I referenced Job earlier. The Job, this righteous man who walked with God, blameless, upright, walked with God, turned away from evil. Those four characteristics that he's shown. That didn't mean Job was perfect. Read the book. Didn't mean he was sinless. Read the book. But Job went to God in a pre-Mosaic time, and he did some kind of sacrifice, some kind of activity before the Lord that he believed would please God, because it was showing that he had a conscious understanding of the fact that he wasn't perfect, that he had blown it. Perhaps some of my children have sinned. I'll make sacrifice for them. Okay, Job didn't have all a great theology of the atonement worked out. But what he knew was that God needed to be satisfied. And what we know is God was satisfied in the sacrifice of his son on the cross. That on the cross, the Son of Man, when he died, satisfied the righteous requirements of his Father. And he engraves that into us, inscribes that into us, so that we don't cling to sin and say it doesn't matter. We don't put it in a box and hide it. We bring it before the Lord, innocent, blameless. No blemish on me, Lord. I'm not perfect, but when I blow it, I come before you, which is just that beautiful character of Christ being imprinted. The third one that we left off last week, we came to this one now. Shine the light in the darkness. And of course, this is the end of verse 15. That you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted and broken and screwed up and ugly and unjust and angry and frustrating and self-absorbed. And I will do what I want no matter what happens to these COVID numbers. Yep. That's the kind of world we're living amongst. That's what our neighbors are like. That's what other folks are out there. That's what we are like way too often. We're part of this generation. But what are we to do as Christians? Among whom you shine as lights in the world. You've heard a fair bit about my son Brandon and Holly these last few weeks as we've welcomed their daughter Gloriana into the world. Our son Brandon has a name that means beacon of light. From Matthew chapter 5 and verse 14, Jesus says to his people, you are the light of the world. A house on a hilltop cannot be hidden. That was a verse I chose when I was baptized. It was the verse that Pam and I chose when we got married. It was the verse that we chose when we had our first home, that we just wanted people to know who lived there. And it's the verse that we used to name our first child. It doesn't say you should be the light of the world. It says, notice in the text here, among whom you shine. You are the light of the world. You are shining. And you'll shine brightly or dimly. You'll shine in a focused way or haphazardly. But you're going to shine. A house on a hilltop can't be hidden. You can't hide. Jesus sets us there and says, there's my people. The people are watching. People are looking. Just like Jesus stands before the world and says he'll draw people to himself. We have that character of Christ implanted and imprinted upon our heart to say it matters what people think of us because God's telling them to look at us. It matters if we live exemplary lives, not just as 1 Peter 5 says, for examples to the flock as leaders, but that if we're an example to the flock, then we are examples to encourage you to be an example, right? It just continues to move that direction. That we don't grumble all the time, that we keep short account, and that we recognize that we shine as lights into the world. You've heard it before, that light changes what it shines upon scientifically. That light illuminates and makes it easy to see. Sometimes what we see is the corruption and the ugliness. It says a crooked and twisted generation. The world needs Christians to shine the light of the gospel upon the craziness of this world. But if we're not living for Jesus as we do, if we're just pointing our finger and telling them about it, telling them how bad they are, then we're just as bad as saying, I want people to think of me better than themselves. The Lord is telling us to go to the world and to exemplify something of the life of Christ, who himself is called the very light of the world. Friends, we are to shine our lights in this twisted and dark generation. One commentator says, our character and our conduct. No outsider would cast a critical verdict that we'd be above criticism. As we shine the light and we show them who they are and they look back at us, our goal is that there's not criticism there. There's not an opportunity for them to say you're just like us. Now, to be sure, we are, but that's not hypocrisy, that's inconsistency. That's immaturity. And that gives us opportunity to continue to grow, even as others see how we live. Number four, we are to hold fast to the word. It says there that among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life. Interestingly, that the better translation almost is holding forth the word of life. Yes, we hold fast to the word. Yes, we don't let go of the word of God, but it's almost in a position of presenting it, holding it forth, holding it up to the world like a runner who brings the flame into the Olympic stadium and holds it up. He's holding tight to it. He's holding fast to it. For what purpose? To hold it forth before the people, that everyone can see it. Shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life, holding forth this light of life so people can see it. Not just that we are holding fast to it, but it's in connection with others out there, those within and without the church. That's what Jesus comes into this world and says, let your light shine before men, that men may see your good works and what? Glorify your Father who's in heaven. The runner is not glorifying himself. He brings it to that wonderful torch and it sets a flame and everyone looks at that and says, there it is. Glorifying our Father who is in heaven. That is the goal of the life that God has given us. Number six, dear friends, we are to make your teachers proud. It's a bit of an odd situation. But you see, the Lord Jesus said, I must always be about my Father's business. The Lord Jesus said in John chapter 6, 37 and following, I've not come to do my will, but the will of him who sent me. Father, glorify your Son, so your Son may glorify thee. There's a connection between Jesus and his Father, the Son and the Father, the Son of God and the Father God. And he says here, listen, holding fast or holding forth the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud. I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. Even if I'm being poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith. Paul says, listen, if you are taking in the truth of the gospel and living it out amongst the world and amongst your brothers and sisters, I'm glad if that's what my life is for. I'm glad if my life comes to an end because of this. This was worth it. I always think of little Eric. Young boy who was the only friend of our son Caleb at our first solo church in Thunder Bay at First Baptist Church. And Eric accidentally took his own life by playing this choking game. And he didn't revive himself. He ended up dying from it. He was a young, goofy, smiley, fun-loving kid who loved Jesus. And in the midst of all of the sorrow of Eric's untimely death, untimely from our perspective, I remember us looking and saying, that kid's life was not wasted. 600 people piled into our church, upstairs, downstairs, jammed in there, from the soccer community on which he played the same team as Caleb. People who had never entered the door of the church walked in and we sang and we preached and we prayed and they heard the word of God. And I remember us saying, it's really sad, but that boy's life was used of the Lord. And every single person in that room was proud of how he had lived his life. He made his parents proud. He made his church family proud. He made his friends proud. The Apostle Paul says, listen, if this is what my life is for, if this is the end of my life, then I'm glad if you will indeed run in such a way that I can watch you smash through the tape. It's like watching your son in the high school or grade school track meet, and you're up in the stands and you're cheering for them. And they pass the tape and they win, or at least they place in the race, and they look up and they see mom and dad and yes, yes, way to go. And we're down like, way to go. Paul says, that's what I want for you. Yeah, brothers and sisters, it makes a difference those who have taught you the word of God, who have modeled the Christian life for you, who sought to pour something of their life into you. Think of this as one of the motivations to live in a way that would please Jesus, that would show the engraving on his hand is real. We'd make those who poured their lives into us proud of what they've done. It wasn't a waste of time. Look, God was pleased to make a difference. And lastly, well, make the work of others worthwhile. He says, even if I'm poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. It's worth it. And it's worth it to the degree that he would take joy. And that we would take joy. Take joy in the workout of our salvation. Likewise, he says, I am glad and rejoice with you all. In verse 18, likewise, you also should be glad and rejoice with me. You should take joy in this, friends. Working out our salvation, taking it for a workout, should bring a delight of the Lord into our lives. Jesus found joy that was set before him. Therefore, he endured the cross, even though he despised its shame. Paul says, I take joy in what I've done, and you should be glad about it as well. Remember, dear friends, there is a reason why our confidence is not in ourself, but confidence in God. That joy and confidence have such a connection that when we find our confidence that God will finish what he started in us, because it's he's the one who's at work, there's a kind of enduring, undergirding joy that lasts in our lives. God, remember, swing back to the beginning, back to verse 12 and 13. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to work all his good pleasure. He's at work, but he's pleased to be at work in this refining, inscribing his character upon our hearts. And we take that salvation and we take it for a workout. That right standing before God, a lot of ways to describe and define salvation, it is at least a right standing, a proper standing, an acceptable standing before the Lord. We take it out and we work it out. That's the word for energy. That's where it comes from. That's where the power comes from. That's why it's connected. That's why Jesus will say, apart from me, you can do nothing. I snap off a branch of this plant and it's going to die because it's not connected anymore. There's no energy passing through it. The Lord is saying, I'm at work. I'm the energy to do it, to plan it and to do it, to will it and to work out all my good pleasure. Isn't that what he's saying in the opening beautiful verses that we said? And I'm sure of this, that he who began a good work, he will bring it to completion on the day of Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. We'll work it out. We'll lay it down. We'll leave it on the field. That's what our lives are for. Because that competent, confidence, assurance that we have, that chapter 49, verse 15, that can a mother forget her nursing child at her breast? Hey, even if she forgets, I will never forget you, for I have inscribed you into the palm of my hands and am always identified along with you. And as we have his name inscribed on his hand, he is inscribing the character of Christ upon our hearts. We live out the prescription to think of others better than ourselves in light of the description of Jesus doing that for the sake of inscribing this inscription of the character of Christ upon our hearts to the glory of his great name. Friends, let's pray together. I thank you, Heavenly Father, that we can have such confidence in days of such uncertainty that you will finish what you started, that you will complete the task, that you will keep us, that you will not let us go. And that as we see evidences of grace in our characters changing, it's not so that you will then love us and save us. It's because you first loved us. Because every Christian is a Christian because of Christ, because of his determination to do us good, because of the gift of faith which causes us to surrender, for goodness sake, already enough trying to do it on our own. Cease striving and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am who I said I am. I will be exalted in the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. We praise you, Heavenly Father, that surrender is even a gift of yours, a gift from you. So please grant it to every ear who's hearing. Everyone who's participated in this message this morning, would you, I pray, dear God, draw us deep and keep us close to you. Engrave your very Son's character upon our lives. Cause us to think the thoughts that Christ thought. Help us, I pray, dear God, to have this mind that was in Christ Jesus, to think of others as better than ourselves, to think of others the way Jesus has already thought of us, to pursue the actions that led from and flowed from his right thinking about us. That was an honor to you and to you, the glory of your great name, Heavenly Father. We pray that that character would be imprinted upon our hearts to the end, that we would find our joy in living our lives, indeed pouring out and laying down our lives for the sake of others' joy, we pray through Christ. Amen.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and around me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, His hands the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world, the birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare the Maker's praise. This is my Father's world, He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear Him pass, He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world, oh let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world, the battle is not done, Jesus who died shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be.